Remember that thumbnail a long time ago of me driving the S600 and it sounded like a straight pipe G35? We're actually gonna explain why the car sounded like a straight pipe G35.
Oh my goodness, Nick, it doesn't need it, but it needs it at the same time. It's so perfect.
Oh my God, this car looks so derp like that, but it's so great. Want one of those?
An LMP3 car.
Where would you drive it, Jimbo?
You can't drive it anywhere. All right, folks, welcome back. So I'm here at AMG Ties, and I'm here with James, the one who pulled the motor in my S600. It's about time we gave you an update on that car. I know a lot of you have been asking me on Instagram, also on my personal page, as well as the Savage Garage page, just saying, like, what happened to the car? Where'd it go? And the truth is, it's a kind of a complicated story. Way back, this was, I think, in August of 2020, I had sent my S600 to Sam from Goichi Motors to have equal length headers done. We were gonna get this project done in like a month. Of course that didn't happen because a lot went into making these headers, but finally we did complete the headers, they got done. This is actually the first time I've ever seen them in person because when Sam put them in the car, he never took the motor out of the car. Like if you look behind you, Blake, and just turn the camera, there's no motor. You know, there's no motor in there. And Sam didn't have that luxury. He didn't do that. He put these godforsaken headers in the car without taking the motor out. So here's one section of spaghetti noodles that was disassembled. Here's the collector. Like, this is so cool. Look at this. These are all individual.
Oh my.
I forgot. So these are literally spaghetti noodles. However, we can look at the one assembled one that's over here, folks. Remember that thumbnail a long time ago of me driving the S600? I'm like, hey, look, we're driving it with open headers. And it sounded like a straight pipe G35. Well, this is what it was coming out of. And we're actually gonna explain why the car sounded like a straight pipe G35. Said exactly what I didn't want to say on video, which was it sounded like a straight pipe G35. And it did. In person, it straight up sounded like just an open header V6. Like we couldn't figure out why it sounded bad. But then we watched the video back. And it's, if you pay very close attention in the video, like, you know, with headphones on and also in person, you could hear it slightly. But it almost sounded like the car was trying to make the noise. Like, you know, if you're blowing through a straw, and let's say if you blow through a straw hard enough, it makes a certain noise, but you know, up until that point, it doesn't make the noise, but you can kind of hear it trying. That's what the car sounded like it was doing. Like, I was thinking to myself, maybe is it like there's a fuel pump that's bad, or like, what's going on? Like, why is the engine cutting power? What would be wrong with the motor? Why would there be a problem with the motor? The car has kind of low miles, right? Well, I'm just as confused as you are, but here's what happened. When I went to go pick up this car, when it had its full exhaust system on it, at the time I drove my 237,000 mile S500 there because I had just picked it up and they looked identical next to each other. And just for shits and giggles, I said, you know what, Blake, let's race the two. Like we went from a stop, we also went at like, I think a 5 or 10 mile an hour roll. I was like, let's just race to like 60, you know, late at night. The cars were dead even to 60 miles an hour. This was 85, 89,000 miles. Original motor, there's no rollback, there's nothing. Like, I can show you the entire history, service history wise of the car. The original car was owned by a hedge fund manager. Every time something broke on it, the car went to the dealer. And then my buddy Blake, who owns the Wanna Go Fast events, he's the one who bought the car, sold it to me. And you know, he, you know, just drove the car, maintained it as is. We never noticed anything wrong with it. We just figured it was slow because it's a, you know, 5,000 pound boat. But when we raced it against a worn out 230,000 mile plus S500 I picked up for $3,000 and they were dead even to 60, I went, there's a problem here. I don't know what it is, but there's a problem. So I sent it to arguably one of the best shops in the country for Mercedes, Blue Ridge MB in Atlanta. And Jonathan, the owner, he's an absolute nut with these old Mercedes. He took a look at the car, he fixed a few small things, but none of which would lead the car to drive like underpowered, like be slow. And then he sent me a photo. And I'll put the photo up on screen for you guys, but his text message was "Ruh-ruh." And I knew exactly what the photo was the moment I saw it, and it was a compression test. Somehow, this old girl has a low compression. And again, you know, I can verify the whole history of this car, all the mileage, the service. There's no reason for this motor to have low compression. I asked Jonathan so many times, like, what could have caused this? What could have caused the motor to have this happen to it? And he said, you know, it could have just been some dipshit who started the car with his foot on the gas. It could have been, you know, someone screwed up in maintenance. There was no check engine lights on the car. The car never sputtered or did anything that would make you go, there's something wrong with this car. It just ran smooth. Nobody knew there was anything wrong with the car. It didn't feel weird. It drove perfectly fine, but it had low compression. What could have caused a less than 100,000 mile M120 motor, V12 from Mercedes, to have low compression? It's very, very unusual. So that's where this motor comes in. So this motor, probably wondering where the hell it came from, because this looks a lot nicer than this one. Well, this motor belonged to my good friend, Steven. I met him years and years ago here in the DMV. He happened, keep in mind, by the way, like Mercedes people are very weird and we just have Mercedes parts laying around. Like, it's a common thing. Mercedes people are extremely weird. And we also have a tendency to have more than one of a particular car or part than we should lately. Just the way it is. But Steven actually assembled this motor with his college professor. So this is a Chery M120. The mileage is unknown. It's somewhere in the 100,000 mile mark. This is going to be a good motor that's gonna go in the car and in theory, make the sounds that we all desire out of my black boat, which is Zonda noises. This is gonna be the first time in a long time this S600 is finally gonna see justice, make the power it's supposed to, and hopefully sound like a screaming banshee at 40 miles an hour. Like, that's my hope. That's where we get to the timeline. James, when do you think we're gonna have this done?
My plan is to install this back into the subframe and get it connected to the trans by the end of the day. Now, that's if everything goes absolutely perfect and there are no snags. Come next week, once all the parts come in, I'm gonna start reinstalling everything. Now, the spaghetti of the exhaust.
Yes.
That's kind of the point where everything is gonna get interesting.
So how are you gonna get back in the car? I assume probably the same way it came in, just raise it in?
That's the thing. We're probably gonna have to remove this oil filter housing on the new one and then install it in the car. And then while it's in the car, try to put the oil filter housing back in.
Yep.
But the problem is the exhaust is also gonna be in there. So I don't know if I can get the oil filter housing out with the exhaust in, just how big it is. So yeah, it's gonna be interesting.
Yep. Just to give you an idea of how much of a pain in the ass working on this car now is with these headers. I took my car at one point, the starter failed in the car. And he's already like, no. Yeah, we were going to film something with Randy in Florida, and Blake, you start the car.
Yep.
And the starter motor it sounded like someone took all the teeth off of it. It was just spinning. I'm like, the starter's dead. Like, so I sent it to MTech in Fort Lauderdale, and they took one look at the car and were like, well, you know, to change the starter, we're gonna need to pull the motor in this car. And I said, okay, I'm gonna send a truck. So then I sent it to Jonathan at Blue Ridge MB up in Atlanta. And 3 days later he goes, so I put a starter in the car. And I said, how the f*** do you do that? And he said, magic. And I, like, that's the only thing that makes any sense.
I know what
because
magic he works.
I have no f***ing clue how he managed to get anything around those headers. Could you show me the starter over here? Like, yeah. So look at all of these.
It's currently connected to wiring, but this starter is no joke.
Oh my god.
A normal car starter is about
like a torpedo.
Half of this. This is the size of a F-350 starter. This thing is huge. It weighs about 15, 20 pounds. The starter is nicely tucked right in here. Uh-huh. That's where it goes, right there.
How the f- did you do that, Jonathan?
And y'all saw all that spaghetti, right? It's underneath all the spaghetti.
How did you do that?
Typically, we would assemble the motor as much as possible. The entire front assembly, all the accessory drives, belt, exhaust manifold, all that stuff would be assembled ideally right here, we would then reattach it to the subframe, reattach it to the trans, hook everything up, and then we slide the entire assembly over to the car's one unit,
yeah.
And then just raise it up a little bit, then just mate them together like a nice little sandwich, and everything works happily. But unfortunately, because this one's a little more complicated,
yeah.
We kind of have to do it in pieces. Currently, I'll transfer everything that's on this one over to this one in exactly how it sits, because that motor mount has to stay there, this motor mount has to stay here, just kind of how it is.
Yeah.
Transfer everything over, pick this one up, put it there. When this one's kind of lower, squeeze in the exhaust, put back the spaghetti noodles, and from that point on, it's the same process of pulling any motor in any subframe. If you've dropped an engine on an engine table, it's basically self-explanatory.
Will it sound the same? Will it sound better? Will it sound worse? You know, we don't know. But that's what's gonna be interesting to find out, because at the end of the day, part of the reason I did this was because it was kind of an experiment. I've read the Jalopnik article. There are other articles that are similar, people saying, you know, how to make your old V12 Mercedes sound like a Zonda. And this will be the first real world test of somebody making them outside of the company who makes them professionally. So this will be like the first one. So I'm really excited to hear what the car sounds like. And also, of course, drive it with full power, because we've never done that yet. And I have a feeling that it's going to be quite interesting. It's going to be very rowdy. And we're going to have to very quickly either weld the diff or get an LSD for it, because that car is a one-wheel peeler right now. But with all that being said, thank you guys for watching this quick little update. More to come, obviously. We're going to be showing off the final everything done on the car, the first drive, everything like that. But with all that being said, thank you all for watching this little update, and we will see you next time. Take care. Mesmerized. I got a text message.
I got a video. Yeah.